We are a welcoming people of diverse beliefs who commit to nourish the spirit, broaden the mind, nurture the earth, and build community. May this flame we kindle remind us to strive today and every day to love beyond belief.
Today's story is titled, What Do You Do With an Idea? Written by Kobe Yamada, illustrated by May Besome. What do you do with an idea? One day, I had an idea. Where did it come from? Why is it here? I wondered, what do you do with an idea? At first, I didn't think much of it. It seemed kind of strange and fragile. I didn't know what to do with it, so I just walked away from it. I acted like it didn't belong to me. But it followed me. I worried what others would think. What would people say about my idea? I kept it to myself. I hid it away and didn't talk about it. I tried to act like everything was the same as it was before my idea showed up. But there was something magical about my idea. I had to admit, I felt better and happier when it was around. It wanted food. It wanted to play. Actually, it wanted a lot of attention. It grew bigger and we became friends. I showed it to other people, even though I was afraid what they would say. I was afraid that if people saw it, they would laugh at it. I was afraid they would think it was silly, and many of them did. They said it was no good. They said it was too weird. They said it was a waste of time and that it would never become anything. And at first, I believed them. I actually thought about giving up on my idea. I almost listened to them. But then I realized, what do they really know? This is my idea, I thought. No one knows it like I do. And it's okay if it's different and weird and maybe a little crazy. I decided to protect it, to care for it. I fed it good food. I worked with it. I played with it. But most of all, I gave it my attention. My idea grew and grew, and so did my love for it. I built it a new house, one with an open roof where it could look up at the stars, a place where it could be safe to dream. I liked being with my idea. It made me feel more alive, like I could do anything. It encouraged me to think big and then to think bigger. It shared its secrets with me. It showed me how to walk on my hands because, it said, it is good to have the ability to see things differently. I couldn't imagine my life without it. Then, one day, something amazing happened. My idea changed right before my very eyes. It spread its wings, took flight, and burst into the sky. I don't know how to describe it, but it went from being here to being everywhere. It wasn't just a part of me anymore. It was now a part of everything. And then I realized what you do with an idea. You change the world. The end. And now we will go ahead with our child dedication.
And so I want to invite forward the Cox family and the Cyril family with Freya and Penny. I invite them forward so that we as a fellowship may dedicate ourselves to these families with children. The ceremony that all of us will now participate in is an ancient one. In all parts of the world and from the earliest days of recorded history, parents have brought their young children to a place of worship where the miracle of birth can be celebrated and also the joy of adoption can be shared with a supportive community of family and friends. This is a public, not a private ceremony, because it marks the fact that all of us have a responsibility for the next generation. Every child is entitled to be received by loving arms and guided with tender care in the paths of truth and understanding. In turn, we adults will greatly be blessed by our children, for they will teach us to look at the mystery of life with a deeper wonder and renewed curiosity. Through their eyes, we will see more clearly the sacredness of one another and the holy all around us. So parents, in asking for the dedication of your child, you are also offering the dedication of yourselves to the fullest development of her body, mind, and spirit. As you already know, your task is not an easy one. There are times when you are called to sacrifice personal ambitions, to deny yourself pleasures, or to set aside your own dreams for the sake of what is best for your child. It takes courageous faith and unconditional love to do this. And this ceremony becomes then a symbol of your resolution to do all that will be required of you as parents. And so I ask you, in the presence of this religious community, do you promise to teach your child by word and example to walk in the ways of truth, beauty, goodness, and love? Do you? Wonderful. And now I invite the relatives and special friends of these families to stand as you are able. The friends and family of the Cox family here. And the friends and family of the Searle family here. And we have Beth's parents, Randy and Marilyn Brown, Charlie's father, Tom, and Charlie's mother, Kathy, as well as Beth's brother and family, David, R.K., James, and Anna Brown. And you can find out who all the Coxes are later. Will you, as family and special friends of these children, support their parents as they undertake the responsibilities that have been expressed here? And will you trust, befriend, and deeply love these young ones? Thank you, and you may be seated. May these promises enrich us all. So I'm going to start with David and Tasha. What name have you given this child? Freya Marie. Her name until and unless she takes another as her own. Freya, we're going to present you this rose, symbol of unfolding beauty, to express our hope that your precious life will unfold in all its unique and natural splendor. She said yes. May your feet keep you grounded. Is that okay? She said yes in the hallway. There we go. May your feet keep you grounded and may you travel lightly upon this earth. May your hands create beauty. There you go. May your mind stay open. And may your heart know love. And would you like to have that flower now, Freya? There you go. You can. Okay, Beth and Charlie, what name have you given to this child? Penny Anne Marie, her name until and unless she takes another as her own. Penny, we present you with this rose, symbol of unfolding beauty, to express our hope that your precious life will unfold in all its unique and natural splendor. May your feet keep you grounded and may you travel lightly upon this earth. May your hands create beauty. May your mind stay open, and may your heart know love. And now, congregation, will you promise to support these families as they entrust their children to our care, nurturing them as your own in body, mind, and spirit? Do you? And will you pledge them your love and support, a listening ear and a helping hand in times of trial? And will you pledge them a community of open-mindedness, a place where their beliefs, their doubts, their questions are received with gentleness and respect? Will you pledge them challenge, skepticism of the too easy answer, and a pointing to the ever-open road? Yes. Thank you. And will you pledge them roots, a tradition to pass on to their own children, and a place to come home? Yes. Thank you, congregation. And on behalf of this congregation, Freya and Penny, I welcome you to our fellowship, for you are the gift of life itself. You are our present delight. By you, we are reminded of life's small joys and wisdoms. You are the heirs of the work that we have done and are doing. You are the next generation unto whom the torch of our tradition shall pass from our hands. You shall build upon the foundations that we lay. You are the yet unwritten chapter in the story of our faith. This is now your congregation. Never be afraid to be yourself within the security and comfort of these walls. And now, Macy, we'll take you downstairs to Children's Chapel if you'd like to go, or you can simply sit with your parents. Yes, and we are going to attempt to sing a cappella, that song that we sing to get them on their way. Can someone start us with that?
Lovely. Help us make this church a refuge from the world, by Reverend Richard Trudeau. Spirit of life, help us make this church a refuge from the world, a place where the rules are different. May this be a place where no experience is necessary, where people are encouraged to risk new things, where a university administrator can try her hand at plumbing if she wants, or a plumber can help manage the finances, or a banker can teach five-year-olds. May this be a place where people always feel that their efforts have been worthwhile and their energy well spent. And may this place be a place where, as in a children's baseball league, everyone gets to play. Oh God, help us make this fellowship a refuge from the world, a place where the rules are different. May no one feel invisible here or feel worried about what others might be thinking of them. May no one be bored here. If a person isn't interested in what the minister is talking about today, may he or she be excited by the music or by a conversation at coffee hour. May this be a place where people are touched, if not by something said, then perhaps by something sung or by the light coming through the windows, or by the sense that the people who come here support one another. May this be a place where everyone feels safe, safe to follow their thoughts wherever they lead, safe to believe whatever they must, and safe to share whatever is on their minds and whatever is in their hearts. Unnameable mystery, Help us make this fellowship a refuge from the world, a place where the rules are different, a place where our wells can fill up again, where we can be refreshed and renewed, so that when we return to the world with our batteries recharged, we can help transform the world into a place where the rules are different.
So let me invite now to the front our newest members. You know who you are. Come on up. You're about to join those who have already made the commitment to our fellowship. Can I get a wave of hands from people who've been here since the 80s? There we go. Yes, there's some 80s people here. How about the 90s? Can you give a wave? There's some waves in the back. How about the 2000-aughts? All right, people joined in the 2000s. What about the 2010s? There we go. And what about the 2020s? Wonderful, a whole spectrum. So many of us, all of us. And so we continue adding and growing, growing in numbers and growing in relationship, changing by growing, yet remaining a fellowship dedicated to nourishing our spirits so that we might serve justice as an expression of our Unitarian Universalist faith. The fellowship endures, each of us part of it for just a little while, the fellowship remaining for much longer. Let us welcome our new members into communion, into community and companionship. Board President Bob Finley and Membership Chair Tricia Nino are here to offer the hand of fellowship and small tokens of our gratitude for your commitment. We recognize and honor today all of those who are signing the book. And the book is over there on that stand, so head that way. We welcome today Natasha and David Cox. There you go. See, there are gifts. And I welcome today Maggie Jones and Bruce Nowlin. That's someone's phone going off. And we welcome today Jaron Osterman. So once you sign your name, you can come back up here, okay? And we welcome today Beth and Charlie Searle. Now, I know you got a lot to do up here, but I'm going to ask you to think about this, these questions, new members. First of all, we are so glad you are with us and that you have chosen this community of fellow seekers to travel with you on your life journeys. Will you accept our gifts of fellowship, discovery, and service? What do you say? All right. Will you offer us your own unique presence and gifts? Will you add your name to the long history of Unitarian Universalist people who spread hope with our living faith? Yes? Is that a yes? Thank you. Will you engage with us as we seek to create a world, community, and a world dedicated to love and justice? Yes, we are so grateful. And congregation, will you welcome these new members into the warmth and comfort of your fellowship?
Yes.
Will you seek to add your strengths and talents to their new gifts? Will you share our triumphs and our struggles as a community that grows and changes willingly?
Yes.
Will you seek them out at coffee hour for a chat?
Yes.
Excellent, excellent. I'm very proud of you, congregation. Let us remember as we join new to longstanding, fresh with experience, let us remember these words of our covenant of right relationships. We commit to encourage and support each other on our individual and collective spiritual journeys because each and every one of us is imperfect and will occasionally break covenant. We will forgive ourselves, each other, and begin again in love. Welcome. We are so glad you are here with us. And you may be seated. Now I'll shift gears, and I invite you now into a time of prayer, reflection, and meditation. Settle into your mind and your body as it is in this moment. Close your eyes or simply soften your gaze. Bring gentle awareness to those parts of you that hurt. Follow your breath. Knowing you are not alone in your pain, no matter its nature. We breathe together into this time of witness and compassion. Open your heart to the spirit of connection. Hear these words from the Reverend Barbara Peskin, prayer for those gathered in worship. In this familiar place, listen to the sounds of breathing, creaking pews, shuffling feet, clearing throats, and sighing all around. Know that each breath, movement, the glance meant for you or intercepted, holds a life within it. These are signs that we choose to be in this company, have things to say to each other, things not yet said, but in each other's presence still, trembling behind our heart's doors. These doors closed, but unlocked, each silent thing waiting on the threshold between knowing and unknowing, between being hidden and being known. Find the silence among these people and listen to it all. Breathing, sighs, movement, holding back. Hear the tears that have not yet reached their eyes. Perhaps they are your own. Hear also the laughter building deep where joy abides despite everything. Listen, rejoice. Let us share a stillness together.
Community because we share meaning, identity, and purpose. We sustain our religious community because we share our financial resources. It is a true mark of Unitarian Universalist polity to voluntarily gather as people and to support ourselves without dependence on any higher authority. Notice the QR code on your Zoom screen and on the pew card. You can use your smartphone to go directly to the giving link on our UUFM webpage. As you enjoy the offertory, consider your monetary gift to our community so that we may grow and flourish, increasingly able to spread compassion and make justice in the larger world. And this month, we take a second collection for the Living Earth Center. What a beautiful gift of voice your daughter has. Hear now this poem from Marge Percy. To be of use. The people I love the best jump into work head first, without dallying in the shallows, and swim off with sure strokes almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in common rhythm when the food must come in or the fire be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real.
So I didn't have as much time this week for writing, which means my 20-minute sermon is now 30 minutes. Just kidding. From my earliest days with you nearly 5 years ago, the name of this congregation has been a something. Not a church, but a fellowship, which for me meant that you might all be kind of cautious about or suspicious of the authority of a minister. There was a little of that, but not too much. One congregant told me how much they liked the name because it reminded them of the Lord of the Rings. I hear that. That's why I picked that announcement music this morning, if you were here early enough for that. Another congregant told me that they liked how UUFM sounds, like a radio station, right? Maybe even an NPR station, right? Proclaiming liberal ideas, especially where most needed. Some others thought we should go with church, more recognizable to folk in the community who are seeking religious life. Church has its own burdens too. Whatever the name, I know this to be a religious community, a faith community, enduring, loving, creative, people moving together, going together. The new and the old morphing, showing life and longevity of the fellowship. None of the founders with you any longer, but still folks seeking to be with you, to bring themselves into relationship with you. There is creativity in this community. This community is creative. Regardless of who your next minister is or when they arrive, the fellowship will endure and transform as a community going together. Last week was a busy week for me. A lot of meetings in person, on calls or texts, through email. Meetings about who might serve as your next minister. Meetings about our Soul Matters sharing circles, where we meet for deliberate spiritual exploration and deepening, not that it doesn't happen elsewhere. Meetings about the financial state and health of the congregation, meetings about how best to care for each other, especially those of us very vulnerable and lonely, and also those of us who extend a lot of care to others. Meetings about publications, both getting out the word about all that we do and are, and properly showing what we think of each other, how deeply we love each other. Meetings to check in with those who made the rummage sale so successful. Meetings to check in with who made the celebration of Jane Schoestag's life so beautiful. Last week was a busy week for me and for many of you as well. Meetings, meetings, and more meetings. Meeting is how we get things done around here. Meeting is how we foster and unleash our creative capabilities. Meeting is how we make fellowship. And meeting is how we make over and over again every day the fellowship. For the fellowship is more than a collective of individuals, as important as each of us as individuals is. We are a collective, a continuing, unfolding part of a religious tradition, a living tradition that endures and changes over time. We are part of the Unitarian Universalist faith tradition, and not just because we pay our dues to the UUA, though we do. From early Christians proclaiming what eventually became heresies, that there is one source of the holy for all, and that love without condition is the most important value animating life. From those heresies expressed historically in many places, independently, in Europe, in India, in the American colonies, we have become a collection of practitioners of other faiths, Hindus, Buddhists, pagans, so many, pulling together with common values, if different beliefs. As Unitarian Universalists, we willingly acquiesce to shared practices alongside other practices meaningful to us, all striving to live more fully with purpose and meaning within a set of values, shared values that proclaim us all as worthy and lovable, all of us deserving of equity, liberation, and justice, all our voices relevant, ourselves, the consciousness of nature, the universe knowing itself. Within Unitarian Universalism and in companionship with other beliefs and many practices of faith, we gather to celebrate all that life presents us, joy and sorrow woven fine. Together we gather because companionship, fellowship is better than loneliness. Here, in meetings and in worship, in shared time and space, we keep faith with each other. We are more than a liberal bastion of leftist thinkers. We are doers in the world, each of us individually and also the fellowship collectively. For activism can be lonely when the work goes on long past the time we think a difference should have been made. Collectively, we are able to remember that the work is the point, digging the well we will not drink from, planting the tree whose shade we will not sit under, building the cathedral in faith and hope for the future generations, because we live in faith and hope that though the world seems grim and stupid on many days, we live in faith and hope. We come together to celebrate the pooling together again and again, and we come as one. We rejoice, a place where the rules are different. May this you remember today and every day, as you remember you are loved, you are worthy, you are welcome, and you are needed. May you feel it so, may it be so, and may we say together, amen.